We hear it all the time on commercials for toothpaste, something like, 9 out of 10 dentists prefer our product to the leading brand. After 7 episodes on data literacy, you probably won't be surprised if we won't just run out and buy the latest minty fresh product. First, we want to know who these dentists are and what exactly they were asked, and why that last dentist keeps holding out. After all, we know that there's a lot of nuance that is not captured in that 9 out of 10 statistic. Marketing materials don't have the time to give the full context. They're trying to grab our attention in a 30-second ad. But the fine print is important, especially when our health is concerned. The health and wellness industry is ultimately a business, and marketing a product as good for our health is one of its most persuasive tactics. We'd be irresponsible if we didn't invest in something that would make us healthier, right? Well, it depends. Today, we'll learn about what to look out for when health data is reported. I'm Jessica Pucci, and welcome to Study Hall Data Literacy, presented by Arizona State University and Crash Course. Carbs, sitting, smartphones, too much sleep, taking vitamins, owning chickens. At one time or another, all these things were studied and deemed bad for our health, or at least someone's health. Who is studied in health research doesn't always look exactly like you or me. Health studies are often narrow because they have to be. To measure the specific effect of a drug on something like blood pressure or insomnia, scientists have to tightly control other variables like the age, race, or gender of study participants. They do this because extra variation in patients, or the possible presence of a confounder, a variable that clouds other relationships, makes it harder to see what a medication or wellness regimen is doing. Or if participants respond because of some other underlying cause, it confuses the whole study. Confounding factors like other medications the patients are on can also hide or change the patient's response. But trying to totally wipe out variation by removing other factors can make a study's results less generalizable or applicable to a broader population. So before believing in the latest wonder drug, look for data gaps in a study or who's not represented. For example, Caroline Criado Perez revealed a pervasive gender data gap in her book Invisible Women, like the one in well-known heart attack symptoms. The symptoms of a heart attack are different depending on your gender, but the ones we're trained to look out for, like left arm pain, typically only show up in cisgender men. Women experiencing heart attacks may be misdiagnosed if they don't present with typical, so in this case male, symptoms, and a lot less research has been done on the symptoms everyone else might experience. And we get it, it can be tempting to report the results from a single study in terms of general health. Journalists and science communicators want the story to be relevant for a wide audience, and people like black and white instructions in headlines like, eat 2 apples a day and avoid the doctor, and dry skin. Medical industries and lobbyists also have a vested interest in a positive finding, but there's a danger in overstating the impact of a particular finding. The good news is, it's rare that only one study is ever conducted for a particular medical phenomenon. Public and private researchers and medical professionals routinely conduct a variety of studies, many of which have topics that overlap. Like, it's pretty clear that stress is bad for our health in a variety of ways, even if we're less sure about the health benefits of a particular de-stressing activity. By collecting results from studies that examine similar drugs or medical situations or wellness regimens on different groups of people, it's possible to piece together a stronger claim and get more context. For example, this is exactly what a group of researchers from Johns Hopkins did to conclude that mindfulness meditation does have some effect on psychological stress. Let's see how a science communicator goes through this process, bringing together multiple studies to strengthen a medical story in the data point. A press release just came in about a fast-acting anti-migraine medication. Reportedly, it shortens the time between taking the drug and the migraine going away. Sounds like a good story, but first the science communicator looks for more information about the study. Her podcast listeners will need some context to see how the findings relate to their own health. She finds the formal paper about the findings by searching their researchers quoted in the press release. Reassuringly, this paper has been peer-reviewed, which means it has been evaluated by others in the same field before being published. So this finding doesn't necessarily help her listeners below age 50 or above 60. But it's still possible this drug has been studied in other age groups. She scans the work cited in the study and searches other academic journals and comes across a few relevant studies. Unfortunately, they're behind a paywall and need extra fees to gain access. She can get the gist of the findings from the freely available abstracts, but to find out more about the study participants, she'll need to see the full papers. But our science communicator is not deterred. She emails the researchers involved in the other papers, and these authors kindly provide access to a copy of the papers. Most of the studies find a positive result, and some involve younger study participants. This all looks promising. To be sure, the science communicator might consult a statistician to help bring together all the results from different studies more formally, using an approach called meta-analysis. These statistical methods combine estimates and margins of error from multiple studies to get one combined answer. Trying to share the whole picture is definitely a big responsibility, and there's even more we can look out for besides data gaps that exclude some people. Suppose you're reading about a new diet pill that's supposed to promote quick weight loss. There's a pretty generic article with the headline, "Eating new carrot supplements can help you lose 20 pounds." But we know not to blindly share a headline because it's probably oversimplified. 20 pounds seems too good to be true. We click through to the article, and while it's pretty vague, thankfully it includes the title of the paper and the journal it's published in way at the bottom. We can follow the science communicator's lead and search to find the details online ourselves. And now that we got our hands on the study, we can see that it weighed participants once a week over the course of several months to test how the pill works. The results are positive, and the study participants seem to cover a broad population. But then you notice that the number of people who weighed in at the beginning of the study is much larger than the number of weigh-ins at the end of the study. Somewhere, we've lost some participants. In studies that take place over time, a phenomenon called dropout can skew the results. Participants who gave up on the diet regimen may be different in some way than those who made it through the whole study. This means the study isn't really as generalizable as it first appears. In this series, we've tackled the problem of self-selection bias, where results are biased by who opted into a study or survey. But medical studies can also be biased by who opts out. Participants can also affect the results through non-compliance or not following the study instructions. Like, they might not drop out of the study altogether, but they could stop taking the supplements as faithfully over time. This wouldn't be a big deal if they told the researchers they'd slipped up. But participants may be embarrassed to tell the truth, so we'll never know that their weight gain during the study isn't because of the new diet. Dropout and non-compliance don't kill a study, but if the analysis doesn't take these possibilities into consideration, the results can be misleading. The motivations behind the study can be misleading too. Following the money doesn't only apply to government investigations. The health food and supplement industry is a business, a big business. The dietary supplement industry alone is worth more than $40 billion. That's billion with a capital B. If it seems too good to be true that drinking a protein shake is gonna give you ripped muscles within a week or the reported numbers are too jaw-dropping, maybe consider some alternative explanations before handing over your money. Like checking that fine print again. Did diet and exercise also play a role in the big transformation presented in an ad? You don't need a pill for that. Or suppose a diet program involves cutting out dairy and subbing in the health food company's dairy-free energy bars. The results are pretty suspect if the study doesn't disclose the funders up front or acknowledge potential conflicts of interest. Money is power, after all. Maybe Big Soy is secretly funding the study in the hopes of promoting alternative milks. It could happen. Health food companies might even have the resources to do the research themselves. That's the capital R in their R&D department. But they may have a more narrow research question in mind, or report a narrower set of findings than a more general science lab would. It's possible the company's energy bars do win a taste test over one competitor's recipe, but not over two others. They could selectively report the positive result while keeping the negative results private. Or even more narrowly, if their energy bar is associated with an advantage on one health outcome, say lower blood sugar, but with a disadvantage on many others, including stable weight loss, the company researchers may still claim success. Other researchers not employed by the company would probably feel freer to report both the pros and the cons of the product. Hope for health is a powerful thing. That's why it's important to evaluate claims made with health data, especially if someone is trying to sell us something. The health and wellness benefits claimed in an ad can overstate how good a product is if we aren't paying attention to the details. So today we learned how to evaluate health-related claims and avoid falling prey to unproven remedies. While you're flipping through stacks of press releases and medical studies, you now know how to keep an eye out for data gaps, dropout, non-compliance, and funding information. These properties of a study impact the generalizability and reliability of its results. We might have to take the rose-colored glasses off, but doing our due diligence to put a specific health finding in context using the collective knowledge of medical experience is an important and data-literate move. Next time, we'll go digital and talk about social media data. Thanks for watching Study Hall Data Literacy, which is produced by Arizona State University and the Crash Course team at Complexly. If you like this video and want to keep learning with us here in Study Hall, be sure to subscribe. You can learn more about ASU and the videos produced by Crash Course in the links in the description. See you next time.